When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to Geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your moves.
Blog Talk Radio.
Tonight's Ace of Cups show, and here's your host, Sister Robina.
Greetings, Robina.
Greetings, Yusiku, and greetings, everyone, and welcome to the Ace of Coach Radio Show. I am your host, Robina Rastavan, a.k.a. The Realist Astrologer, and I hope everyone is enjoying the fall season so far. I definitely am. I live in Phoenix, Arizona, so we have very hot summers, so when the month of October comes around, that's when it starts cooling down and the weather is beautiful, so I'm really into the whole fall spirit right now. The weather, usually the temperature ranges between like the high 80s and the low 90s around this time of the year in Phoenix, Arizona. But for us, it feels really cool. And then it cools down tremendously at night. So I just hope everybody is having a good fall season so far. This month is really flying by. I'm just like, wow. And it seems that over the past decade or so, time in general has sped up tremendously. And I'm not the only one who feels that way. So if anybody in my listening audience feels that way and you want to contribute to just that notion, please feel free when I open up the phone lines in hour two. So I have a lot to discuss tonight, some of which borders on the line of conspiracy theory. Now, most people would consider me a conspiracy theorist if they heard a lot of my views and opinions. But I simply see myself as a seeker and speaker of truth. I'm a Sagittarius, so truth is paramount for me. So this is episode 4 of my new radio show, courtesy of the Ringing Stone Network. This episode is entitled, The Nepturanian Generation, Are They Lost or Simply Too Evolved for This World? Now, we'll kick off episode 4 of the Ace of Cups radio show with a brief discussion where I shed some metaphysical insight on a few current events, including the recent backlash that Dr. Dre has been receiving as a result of his depiction in the Michel’le Biopic Surviving Compton. Next, to close out Libra season, we'll get into relationship profiles in relation to astrology. I'm going to provide some real-world examples for various manifestations of Venus and Libra per sign. Libra is ruled by the planet Venus. So I'm going to provide some real-world examples per sign, house, and aspect. Now, during the second half of hour one, I will get into the main topic of the evening, the Nepturanian generation. That's a term I've coined to describe those individuals who were born between 1989 and 1996. And I see this segment of the population being in a precarious position a lot of times, a lot of them. And a lot of times it seems like they're lost and they don't really know how they fit into the whole scheme of things in terms of the world. So I just wanted to talk about that in the second half of this first hour. And then in hour two, I'm going to open up the phone lines for listeners to join in on the discussion and to provide some free mini readings. So let's just get started. So, let me just mention, in my next episode, episode 5, I'm going to bring on a guest. So I'll start bringing on guests to interview and to contribute to metaphysical knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. I just wanted to have these first 4 episodes with just me, just so people could get into, just so I could get into the swing of things, and people can basically see where I'm coming from and understand my vibe and my perspective on things. So the next episode, I'll be bringing on a guest. Most likely it will be a female, so please stay tuned for that. So getting into the Dr. Dre and Michel’le fiasco. So I'm just going to read a little bit of what I found online. It says the late 80s R&B star is subject of a new biopic, Surviving Compton, Dre, Suge, and Me, which debuted over the weekend on Lifetime. It covers much of the same ground as the N.W.A. film, the volatile late 80s and 90s, when N.W.A.'s hardcore hip-hop swept the nation. But Straight Outta Compton didn't show how Michel’le's radio-friendly ballads and up-tempo dance tracks helped pave the way for ruthless mainstream credibility. It also failed to portray N.W.A. producer Dr. Dre's repeated violence against women. Now, it has been said many times that Dr. Dre has been violent. There was this story that came out in the early 90s where he assaulted this female. I believe her name was Dee, but she was a host of this hip-hop radio show or this hip-hop video show. But so, yeah, he has a history of abuse.
So basically, it says that violence that Michel’le, Drake's former long-term girlfriend and mother of his son Marcel, alleges as well. Prior to its release, Dr. Dre's lawyers threatened legal action against the filmmakers if the movie contained scenes of him assaulting her, which he denies. Now, one thing I've noticed about abusers, oftentimes they do get a case of amnesia when the victim of abuse brings up their past abuse. So this doesn't surprise me at all, his response. So like I said, his lawyers have threatened legal action against the filmmakers if the movie contains scenes of him assaulting her. But Surviving Compton nonetheless contains numerous chilling sequences of Dre beating her, and even one where he shoots at her. He otherwise portrayed as a cheating, boozing manipulator who neglects her once he becomes famous. So with that being said, I just wanted to get into his birth chart and numerology a little bit, and also Michel’le's birth chart and numerology. So Dr. Dre was born on February 18th, 1965. Now, he's a Pisces, but he's an 18. So let me tell you about the number 18. The number 18 is one of the more challenging numbers to be born under. It's a very aggressive number. It's a number where there's a lot of pent-up anger and aggression that oftentimes cannot be released, or that the person doesn't release until they get to a breaking point, and then all hell breaks loose. Couple that with the fact that he is a mutable sign, Pisces, and what I say about mutable signs is they're very volatile and they're prone to extreme acts of violence. Now, Pisces is a very softened, sensitive, and subdued sign, but like I said, him being born on the 18th, that makes him more of a hardened Pisces, because 18 breaks down to 9, and that's Mars energy. Now, he also has Sun conjunct Saturn in Pisces. So Sun conjunct Saturn can make somebody that's very controlling, has a hard time letting go of control or giving control to others, has a hard time with authority figures, and may even have abusive tendencies if he feels like he cannot wield control over the person he's trying to control. He also has Mars and Pluto in Virgo, which is another mutable sign. So again, like I said, mutable signs are very volatile and they're prone to extreme violence. And he has his North Node in Gemini, which is another mutable sign. So he's working with a lot of mutable energy. His South Node is in Sagittarius, which is a mutable sign, and Sagittarius is prone to extreme anger and even violence when they feel like their freedom is being inhibited or restricted, or when they just feel like they don't have any control. So he definitely has the setup astrologically to be an abusive person, in my opinion. Now, Michel’le was born on December 5th, 1970. December 5th, that's my birthday, so that's interesting. She's a Sagittarius. Now, I had to look into her chart because I was curious about, I was like, where did she get that squeaky voice from? And the thing with astrology is life. So everything that goes on in a person's life can be explained through the natal chart or subsequent charts. So with her being born on December 5th, 1970, she is a Sagittarius, and she's quite a talented Sagittarius because the number 5 can deal with someone who's versatile and multi-talented. She's also one who is an intellectual Sagittarius, even though she may come across as kind of like an airhead at times. Don't get it twisted. She is smarter than she appears to be, being born on the 5th. However, also being born on the 5th, there's a tendency to be scattered, to lack direction at times, and to just kind of be taken off of your path. Number 5 is very prone to be distracted. So, like I said, I was looking at her chart. I wanted to see where did she get that infantile voice from, that cartoonish voice? So I looked at her Mercury, because Mercury deals with communication, and her Mercury's in Capricorn, and it's in sesquicentennial, which is a challenging aspect, to Saturn and Taurus. Now, what's interesting is Taurus deals with the voice and also the vocal cords, which the voice is derived from. So Saturn and Taurus can deal with an issue with either the throat or the vocal cords. Saturn can deal with a deficiency or something that is undeveloped. So in her case, it's undeveloped vocal cords. So I don't know if this she's ever, you know, spoke about this, about, you know, that a doctor has diagnosed her with that, but she definitely can wail when it comes to singing. However, her speaking voice is very shrill, is very infantile, and it's cartoonish. So there's definitely, you know, something, that dichotomy going on, and dichotomy is very very akin to the number five, because the number five is Mercury energy, and Mercury has a lot of that dichotomy going on. So Saturn is at the 17th degree in Taurus, so that compounds that energy of Saturn, because 17 breaks down to 8, and 8 vibrates to the planet Saturn. So, like I said, that's testament right there that she has some type of issue with her vocal cords. And to me, I believe the way you can explain it, the dichotomy between her speaking voice and her singing voice, when she's speaking from the top of her, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, anybody that's, you know, knowledgeable of singing, but she's speaking from the top of her diaphragm from the top of her vocal cords. But then when she's singing deep inside her gut, like her diaphragm. So she's bringing that voice up deep from within herself. So that's how she's able to pull that deep, rich voice out. Now, what's interesting is she has the asteroid Juno in conjunction, which is right next to it, right by Saturn and Taurus. Now, Juno deals with the major beef or bone of contention in your relationships. So in the I saw a little bit of that biopic, Surviving Compton, and towards the beginning, she was being auditioned by the world-class wrecking crew, and they were making fun of her voice. So, like I said, the asteroid Juno deals with the bone of contention or beef in her relationships and relationships of all kinds. So that deals with that right there. You know, she's always had to deal with the humiliation of her voice. Also, she mentioned that when she was in a relationship with Dr. Dre, she didn't have a voice. Basically, she just was told to just shut up, sit down, and just do what you're told. So that is also Juno conjunct Taurus, conjunct Saturn and Taurus as well, her not having a voice in her relationships. And I would think with that shrill, cartoonish voice that it would be hard for people to take her seriously at times. I know, you know, it'd be hard for me to take her seriously. And actually, I was a little taken aback when I found out that we shared the same birthday, because I was like, oh, God. Like, but, you know, I'm not trying to take digs at her, but I was just like, wow. That's why I had to dig a little bit into her natal chart to see, you know, where is she getting that shrill voice from. So when I put the two of their charts together, Dr. Dre and Michel’le, they have a lot of challenging aspects between each other, between their two charts. And a lot of these aspects are volatile. She has her sun in Sagittarius. It's in square to his Pluto and Uranus in Virgo. So like I said, mutable signs. Virgo and Sagittarius, they're mutable signs. They're prone to volatility and violence. So that right there is an aspect that can lead to abuse in a relationship. Sun square Pluto. It also deals with being under his control, her feeling like she didn't have any freedom, her feeling like she didn't have any say in the relationship. Also, most likely with that sun square Pluto, her sun square his Pluto, and Uranus in Virgo, most likely he was cheating all over her as well. Now, her Mars is in semi-square, which is another challenging aspect to his Pluto. So that is another aspect that can be prone to abuse in a relationship. And again, with it being an aspect to his Pluto, that's him overpowering her and having control over her. Her Venus is in semi-square to his Mars. That's a challenging aspect in a relationship. When you're looking at relationship compatibility, one of the main factors to look at is one person's Mars in relation to the other person's Venus. So if there's a challenging aspect between one person's Mars and the other person's Venus, well, you know that there's going to be an imbalance, a distinct imbalance within that relationship that's going to be very hard to overcome. Like, it's going to take, you know, conscious effort on both sides to achieve balance. Usually the person with the Mars is going to be wielding more power and more control. And in this case, it's Dr. Dre's Mars in challenging aspect to her Venus. So far, everything that she's claiming seems like it's, you know, very probable. Her Mars is in semi-square to his Uranus. Her Uranus is in sesquisquare to his Sun. So that right there deals with that biopic that has come out. Also, she's saying that she's not done spilling the tea on Dr. Dre because she plans to write a tell-all book. So her Uranus and challenging aspect to his Sun, her Uranus deals with telling her truth. It's in challenging aspect to his Sun that deals with his identity. That can also deal with his fame, his status, his reputation as a celebrity. So that deals with, you know, this biopic prompting him to get his lawyers involved and writing that cease and desist letter, which didn't work anyway. And I'm going to tell you why it didn't work, because he has this transit going down right now. Transiting Saturn is in Sagittarius, and transits are the current movement of the planets. So transiting Saturn is in Sagittarius right now, and it's making a square to his Uranus in Virgo. So Sagittarius deals with the law. It also deals with the truth, and Uranus deals with the truth as well, and it's in Virgo. So that deals with people that are under his employ or people that he has working for him. So like I say, he got his lawyers to file that cease and desist letter, but it was unsuccessful because he has that Saturn square Uranus transit right now. Saturn will bring things to light, things that you've been trying, especially when it's in aspect to Uranus. It will bring things to light that you were trying to keep under wraps, Saturn in Sagittarius in particular. So if you were doing some dirt, Saturn is like that reality check, you know, you're going to get. Now, also transiting Pluto along with Mars, they're both in Capricorn right now, it's making a challenging aspect to his Sun. So that can deal with him feeling like he's being overpowered. It could deal with feeling like he's his name is being dragged through the mud. In Pluto in particular, it could deal with his downfall. I'm sorry, in Capricorn in particular, it could deal with his downfall, because Capricorn can deal with one's downfall. Capricorn can bring you to great heights in terms of your professional life, but it can also lead to your downfall as well. So that's that. So when I open up the phone lines, if you want to contribute to this discussion on Michel’le and Dr. Dre, please feel free to do that. I am leaning on the side of what Michel’le is claiming, especially because of things that have been said about Dr. Dre in the past. He definitely has a shady character to him, and that a lot of that could deal with that Sun conjunct Saturn in Pisces. Pisces, when the dark-sided manifestation of Pisces can often deal with one who is prone to deception, one that, you know, is prone to addiction, one that is prone to delusion, and also victimization. Now, Pisces, like I said, is a very peaceful sign. It's one that is prone to being victimized. But like I said, with him being born on the 18th, that's a very aggressive number. So he's the one, he's more prone to do the victimizing. And also with all that thing, all that energy he has going on in his chart. Okay, so moving along. So to close out Libra season, I just wanted to get a little deeper into Libra and Libra's ruling planet, Venus, and how they can manifest in real life, namely in terms of personal relationships. So I have two subjects, and these subjects, they're actual people, and their names will be kept anonymous. Now, subject A, she's a female. She has Moon conjoined to Uranus in Libra. As I said, the conjunction means that two planetary bodies are side by side. They're close to each other. So she has Moon conjunct Uranus in Libra opposing Chiron in Aries. That right there is difficult enough as it is, because that makes you prone to be in relationships where your partner may exert a tremendous amount of will over you, and where you may feel like you're not much of an individual in your own right while you're in a relationship. So you might always have to, it might always be this struggle for independence, especially on the home front. And there could be issues with your spouse's family with the Moon conjoined to Uranus in Libra, opposing Chiron in Aries. And the moon conjoined to Uranus is also making a semi-square to Neptune in Sagittarius. She also has Sun square Saturn. Now, her husband died and left her with a major legal battle as a result of his shady business practices involving a business partner. Now, that's the epitome of the dark manifestations of Libra right there. So the legal battle, that's the dark manifestation of Libra. His shady business practices with his business partner, that is Libra right there. Now, she, like I said, she has Sun square Saturn. The Sun in a woman's chart can deal with her husband. And square to Saturn, it can deal with the death of a husband, losing your husband through death, through an untimely death. So there it is right there. Moon conjoined to Uranus and Libra can also deal with her feeling a sense of abandonment and feeling like she's been left out to the wolves as a result of her husband's death and her leaving her with these legal battles. In the end, she was triumphant, and, you know, she managed to get things settled on the legal end. However, it still created a lot of pain within her because he was living a secret life, and she had no idea. So, like I said, she had Moon conjoined to Uranus in Libra, and it was making a semi-square to Neptune in Sagittarius. So Neptune can deal with deception. It can deal with, you know, someone that's living, that has a hidden or secret life or secret affairs. She also had Venus in Leo in the ninth. The ninth house can deal with legal concerns. And I believe this was, some of it was wrapped up into international affairs. And it was in challenging aspect to her Sun conjoined to Mars in Virgo. So her Sun conjoined to Mars, like I said, the Sun in a woman's chart can deal with her husband. When the Sun and Mars are together, there's a good chance that the woman is going to attract a husband that is very selfish or very self-absorbed, or he might be even abusive in some ways. And I believe she might have been doing some work for him. So Sun conjunct Mars in Virgo can deal with her being his employee. If I'm not mistaken, I believe she was either his secretary or she was doing some type of work for him, keeping things organized for him. That's very Sun conjunct Mars in Virgo in relation to a woman's husband. She also had Pluto in Libra. There's that Libra influence again. It was in square to Jupiter in Sagittarius. So that can deal with issues within a relationship. And again, Jupiter in Sagittarius can deal with legal concerns. Libra can deal with legal concerns. And what's interesting is I spoke about the asteroid Juno and how that relates to the main bone of contention or the main beef in a relationship. Her Juno is at what? 25 degrees Libra. So there it is right there. Her Juno at 25 degrees Libra can deal with her getting caught up in a legal battle as a result of her husband's negligence or his deceptive affairs. 25 is at 25 degrees, breaks down to 7. 7 can deal with deception because 7 vibrates to the planet Neptune. So that's example A of how Libra and Venus can manifest in real-world terms. So let me get into subject B. Now, subject B is a Libra rising. And let me tell you something about Libra rising. That's one of the more challenging rising signs to be born under. And the reason for that is, oftentimes, the person looks too much to other people to define themselves, or they might give themselves over to others too willingly and become a doormat for others, or there's a tendency for that person to give relationships such a high priority that they forsake everything else in life, or that relationship becomes the end-all, be-all, and that's exactly what's happening with subject B. Subject B is another female. She has, like I said, she's a Libra rising. That's a very challenging rising sign. She has Pluto right on her ascendant. The ascendant is right where it basically deals with the point where you're actually born, where you actually take your first breath, where you come out of the womb. She has Pluto right on her ascendant, but Pluto is in the 12th house. So Pluto on her ascendant can make her very obsessive when it comes to her relationship. And it can deal with a regenerative effect where the relationship just keeps going on and on and on, or it's going through various rebirth cycles, but it's really not growing or it's not going anywhere, or the relationship has outlived its usefulness, but she feels trapped. That's the Pluto in the 12th house in Libra. She feels trapped in the relationship because she's so dependent upon being in a relationship, which is Libra rising, in order to feel like she is viable, like she's validated. Now, Venus rules Libra, and it rules her ascendant. It rules her entire chart. And Venus is in Pisces in her fifth house. Now, on the surface, you know, in terms of astrological principles, Venus in Pisces is a really good place for Venus. Venus in the fifth house is a really good place. Now, that's in general. So you can't just take things at face value. You have to look at the connections that Venus is making to other points in the chart. So Venus is in pretty bad shape in this woman's chart because it's right next to her south node. South node can be seen as what is termed in astrology a malefic or a planetary body or point that brings a lot of misfortune, that brings trouble, that brings severe challenges. So she has Venus right next to her south node, which can denote a karmic relationship, but one that can be destructive and one where, you know, you feel like you're trapped in it. So again, that south node deals with karma, and that south node can keep you trapped in behavioral patterns that no longer benefit you. So I got to go back, because I forgot to mention this part. I got to go back to her Pluto in the 12th house and it being right on her ascendant. Basically, this woman has, she married this man. She had a child with this man. Then they got a divorce. Mind you, this was a client of mine. So she came to me when she was still married, and she told me that her marriage was, you know, in trouble and she wanted to save it. And matter of fact, she didn't even give me those details at first. That's right. Now I'm thinking back. She didn't give me hardly any details, but basically I did a tarot reading for her and I told her she was headed for divorce, and I even gave her a time frame. And she responded back to me like, no, that doesn't sound like my husband at all. I don't believe you. This doesn't sound right. You know, we're going to stay together, whatever. So basically 6 months later, she ended up getting a divorce, just like I had predicted. So she got a divorce, but she was not done. She still wanted to be with this man. So they ended up getting back together and trying to work things out. And now she and him are talking about possibly getting remarried. However, he lives at home with his mother. She lives with her mother. And the relationship is just highly dysfunctional. With her Venus in the fifth house, conjoined to her south node, the fifth house can deal with children. She's a Capricorn, and Capricorns oftentimes can lack nurturing and lack sensitivity. She's also an 18. She was born on the 18th. So, again, going back to that number 18, it's a very challenging number. It's a number that can be very self-absorbed, selfish even. She has no emotional connection to her child, and she's fine with that. You know, she understands who she is. She understands that she's not capable of giving her child what she what the child needs. She even refers to this child as the boy, not really as her son. So there's this emotional detachment that she has going on. She has Moon in Aquarius that deals with that all day, having that emotional detachment as a parent. And most likely it stems from her relationship with her own mother. But with that being said, her child, her ex-husband has custody of her son, and she has to pay child support. So that's Pluto conjoined to the ascendant in Libra. Pluto can deal with child support, especially in Libra. So she's trapped. She feels trapped at that 12th house energy. She also dealing with that child support issue. Venus also rules her 8th house, which is akin to Plutonian energy. It's basically Scorpio's house. Pluto rules Scorpio. So Venus rules her 8th house through Taurus. That's the child support right there. Now her ex-husband happens to be, guess what, a Libra. And his son is in her 1st house. So that basically underscores the whole theme of her putting this whole relationship at the apex of her entire life. This relationship is the end-all, be-all. And she is, as a Capricorn, she's very ambitious when it comes to relationships and when it comes to trying to make a relationship work, and she will be in it for the very long haul until there's no signs of life whatsoever. Now, his Pluto is in Libra, and it's making a quincunx to her Venus. So he's basically wielding a lot of control in this relationship. Basically, it's his way or the highway. I've told her that numerous times. But she still, you know, tries to wield some type of control and tries to gain leverage through certain, you know, tactics or what have you. But that's subject B. So that's my example of the manifestations of two examples of the manifestations of Libra and Venus and how it can pertain to one's relationship. Oftentimes, we want to look to Libra as being the sign of balance, as things being, you know, all about beauty and artistic expression, but there is a very dark side of Libra that often manifests through relationships, through marriage, through long-term commitments. So I just gave you two examples of the dark manifestations of Libra. So let's get into the main topic of tonight. I got to take a drink because my mouth is getting dry. So the main topic of tonight is the Nepturanian generation. Are they lost or simply too evolved for this world? Now, I coined the term Nepturanian generation to describe the segment of the population of individuals who were born between 1989 and 1996. And this deals with the Uranus-Neptune in Capricorn conjunction that took place between that time period. So I call these people that were born between 1989 and 1996 Nepturanians because I believe that they've been given a special mission in life. I feel like oftentimes a lot of these people, and these people would be in their late teens, early 20s that we're talking about. So if you notice, a lot of the younger generation, a lot of people in their late teens, early 20s, they seem lost. They seem like they have a hard time respecting authority. They have a hard time, you know, holding down a job or finding a job. They have a hard time leaving the nest. They cling very tightly to their parents, or they might have a lot of angst and animosity towards their parents. They do not respect authority, and they don't respect people in general. And a lot of them lack a work ethic in general. So I was just going to get into Uranus and Neptune and their ingress into Capricorn, and all of the things that were going down there during this time period and how it relates to the individuals that were born between the time frame that I specified, 1989 to 1996. Now, Neptune was in Capricorn between 1984 and 1998. Now, I'm going to get a little political here. I'm also, this is where I'm going to get into a little conspiracy theory too, but a lot of this has been verified. A lot of this is public information, Freedom of Information Act, a lot of this has already been exposed, but some of it will border on the range of conspiracy theory. So, like I said, Neptune entered Capricorn in 1984, and it left Capricorn in 1998. So, Neptune can, among other things, deal with drugs. So, just think about in the early 80s, how the CIA, Capricorn deals with governments, how the CIA flooded urban areas with crack cocaine. The drug trade became big business. Big business is Capricorn. So Neptune in Capricorn is big business in terms of the drug trade. So just think about Miami's cocaine golden era, a la Scarface in the 80s. Basically, major corporations got fat off of the drug trade, chiefly in Miami back in the 80s. If you don't know about this, just first of all, watch the movie Scarface. Most people have seen Scarface, but for you younger generations, if you haven't seen Scarface, watch Scarface, because it is the epitome of Neptune in Capricorn, because it shows you that it wasn't just the drug dealers involved. It was the government. It was the banks, big business, Capricorn. Now, also another Neptune in Capricorn event was the Iran-Contra scandal. Neptune deals with scandal, deals with secrets, and also hostages. So according to Wikipedia, the Iran-Contra scandal was a political scandal in the United States that occurred during the second term of the Reagan administration. Senior administration officials secretly facilitated the sale of arms to Iran, which was the subject of an arms embargo. They hoped thereby to secure the release of several U.S. hostages and to fund the Contras in Nicaragua. Under the Boland Amendment, further funding of the Contras by the government had been prohibited by Congress. So those are just two manifestations of Neptune in Capricorn in the 80s. Now, Uranus entered Capricorn in 1988, and it left the sign of the goat in 1996. So an example of the manifestation of Uranus entering Capricorn, on November 9, 1989, the Berlin Wall that divided Eastern and Western Germany was torn down, as signifying the end of the Cold War. So it's no surprise to me that this occurred on the 9th, since that's Mars energy, and Mars deals with destruction, demolition, and also a new beginning. So, that whole breaking down of the Berlin Wall, because Uranus deals with revolution, Capricorn deals with government and system. Now, right when Uranus, remember, Uranus deals with revolution, it could also deal with equal rights between the sexes. Right when Uranus was on the cusp of Capricorn, on December 2nd, 1988, Benazir Bhutto was sworn in as Prime Minister of Pakistan, becoming the first woman to head the government of an Islam-dominated state. So that was very revolutionary. So that's Uranus and Capricorn all day. That happened right on the cusp of Uranus and Capricorn on December 2nd, 1988. Also on that same date, a cyclone in Bangladesh left 5 million homeless and thousands dead. Uranus can bring sudden upheavals, catastrophes, and even natural disasters. Also, when Uranus was entering Capricorn right in the beginning, and this Uranus entered Capricorn on December 3rd of 1988, on December 7th in Soviet Armenia, the MS 6.8 Spitak earthquake kills nearly 25,000, injures 31,000, and leaves 400,000 homeless. Talk about upheaval. That's Uranus and Capricorn all day, especially dealing with earthquakes. On December 21st, this is probably the most memorable event that people will remember that pertains to Uranus and Capricorn. On December 21st, Pan Am Flight 103 was blown up over Lockerbie, Scotland, killing a total of 270 people. Those responsible were believed to be Libyans. Now, here's where my conspiracy theorist hat, where I put on my conspiracy theorist hat, I believe that there was some type of conspiracy going on with that, but moving along. Other events pertaining to Uranus and Capricorn: Drexel, Burnham, Lambert agreed to plead guilty to insider trading and other violations and pay penalties of $650 million. Uranus deals with the truth and being exposed. Also on December 22nd, Brazilian union and environmental activist Chico Mendes was assassinated. Uranus deals with activism and revolution. So those are just some of the manifestations of Uranus' ingress into Capricorn in 1988. Now, knowing how destructive, nefarious, and volatile both of these planets can be in Capricorn, just think about what it can do to an individual who has this combo afflicting his or her personal planets in the natal chart. So the personal planets are the Sun, Moon, Mercury, Venus, and Mars. So for individuals that were born in that time frame, like I said, between 1989 and 1996, if they were born where their personal planets we're in a challenging aspect to this conjunction of Uranus and Neptune and Capricorn, they're going to have some distinct challenges that they need to overcome in life. So I'm going to go into some of the challenges and also some of the go further into some of the events that took place during this time period. So let me just discuss why this whole conjunction intrigues me. Because I used to be a social worker. I have extensive experience as a social worker. I've worked at homeless shelters. I've worked with disadvantaged, at-risk youth in schools and in their surrounding communities. I've worked with kids with who have been diagnosed with ADHD and oppositional defiant disorder, other personality disorders. I've had to supervise children who were on meds like Ritalin and what's that other one? I forget what that other one is called. But I'm going to get into that a little bit. So these two heavy hitters, Uranus and Neptune, they were conjoined in Capricorn between the years of 1990 and 1996, with 1992 and 1993 being years when this conjunction was the tightest. So anyone born between 1992 and 1993, If Uranus and Neptune is making a challenging aspect to either their Sun, Moon, Mercury, Mars, or Venus, they may have some distinct challenges, namely in the area of physical health and mental health, and also their ability to just find a place in the world and to also their ability to get along in terms of social activity, social interaction. Now, in that time period between 1990 and 1996, there were approximately 28 million live births. So this is a sizable number of the population we're talking about here. Now, a lot of people born during this time period have a very hard time finding their purpose and their place in the world, like I said. They tend to be very eccentric, odd, weird, rebellious, and they tend to lack respect for anyone, but especially authority figures. The lack of a work ethic, for the most part, and they are filled with apathy and angst for the most part, especially with respect to systems and authority figures. Now, this group of individuals, they rail against the system. That's Uranus, railing against the system or wanting to rebel. But they are also utterly dependent upon the same system that they desperately try to rebel against. So that's Neptune, them being enslaved to a system, but them wanting to rebel against that system at the same time. So that's that dichotomy with Uranus and Neptune. Uranus and Neptune have very different manifestations. The system is Capricorn. Capricorn also deals with fatherhood or just patriarchy, also discipline and authority figures, and the government. So with Uranus and Neptune and Capricorn, essentially government becomes Big Papa. Also, during this time period, you saw the increase in the influence from child protective services. They became more prevalent in the lives of Americans. But it seemed like it was for all the wrong reasons. Like, they wanted to basically take away parents' rights to discipline their child in the manner that they see fit. Now, I'm no fan of, like, corporal punishment. However, I believe when it comes to some children, sometimes, you know, they might need to, you know, some children only respond to heavy-handedness or tough love. Other children don't need it. But like I said, it seemed like during this time period, CPS really started to ramp up their intrusiveness upon the lives of Americans, and a lot of people ended up getting cases for the wrong reasons. And it seemed like the abuse of children is just continue to increase, and we continue to see more stories about children being neglected, children being abused in worse ways. But it seemed like CPS was going after the people really weren't doing anything wrong, people that might have had a unique religious or spirituality, and they were being wrongly persecuted as a result. Now, it's not all bad with this Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, because some very enlightened individuals have also emerged during this precarious time period, and they are largely responsible for the major growth in the New Age occult and spirituality industries. This is because they accept what cannot be seen more readily than their predecessors, chiefly due to this being the digital age. They were born during the digital age or during their emergence of the digital age. And it's also because they have found traditional religion to be lacking for the most part. And this is cheaply exemplified by Neptune and Capricorn, since Capricorn deals with lack and Neptune deals with spirituality. Now, as this generation ages, they will also bring forth cutting-edge technologies, inventions, and innovations that those of previous generations could never even fathom. So that's the blessing of this conjunction. But some of the curses of this conjunction is that Gulf War. The Gulf War began in 1990, the first Gulf War, that was under Bush Sr. It began in 1990 and it ended in 1991. And as a result, there was this disease that came on the scene called Gulf War Syndrome. Now, according to Wikipedia, Gulf War Syndrome is a medical condition affecting many veterans of the 1991 Gulf War, causing fatigue, that's Neptune, chronic headaches and skin, that's Capricorn, and respiratory disorders. Its origin is uncertain, though it has been attributed to exposure to a combination of pesticides, vaccines, and other chemicals. That's Uranus conjoined to Neptune and Capricorn all day. Suggested causes have included depleted uranium, sarin gas, smoke from burning oil, wells, vaccinations, combat stress, and psychological factors. Now, these veterans that came back with this Gulf War syndrome, they just weren't affected. You also have to think about what was in their sperm or what was in, you know, their ovaries as a result of coming back. So they could have been having children that had some of the symptoms of this Gulf War syndrome. So you have to take that into account as well. That Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, in my opinion, had serious implications in terms of the health of the population in the United States. So more on that. Now, Capricorn rules the government. It also rules the presidency. So Bush Sr. was president between 1989 and 1993, and then Clinton was president between 1993 and 2001. So President Bush Sr. and Clinton, they were the ones responsible for a lot of the changes in government policies during that time period that I'm specifying. Now, the country experienced a major paradigm shift in terms of technology, but also the overall economy and the increased intrusion from government. Also, think about the war on drugs, which is Neptune and Capricorn. And remember, take it back to what I said about the CIA flooding urban areas with crack cocaine in the 80s when Neptune ingressed into Capricorn. So also with Neptune and Capricorn and Uranus and Capricorn, you saw the rise of the pharmaceutical industry. So according to statnews.com, the FDA decided in 1997 to relax its rules. In their TV spots, drug makers could now refer viewers to print ads, offer 1-800 numbers or websites that urge people to talk to their doctor if they wanted that additional information that the FDA previously required for TV ads. So basically, the FDA lacks their policy or regulations on the pharmaceutical industry and their ability to advertise prescription drugs on TV. And that resulted in that industry ballooning from $360 million in 1995 to $1.3 billion in 1998. So more than ever before, Americans were taking tons of pharmaceuticals, and it still hasn't slowed down. Also, during this time period, you saw a rise in vaccinations. Basically, over time, since the 50s, there has been a 414% increase in vaccinations given to U.S. children. In 1950, your child would have received 7 vaccines by the age of 6. In 2013, it's up to 36 vaccinations. Now, the shift that has resulted in major increase of recommended vaccination occurred during the Uranus and Neptune sojourn through Capricorn, Now, there is a direct correlation between the rise in recommended vaccines and the increase in neurological disorders such as autism. Also, food allergies as well. So that, again, in my opinion, is a manifestation of Uranus and Neptune in Capricorn. So, and then think about Capricorn, it deals with the skin. Neptune deals with the medical industry. They're given vaccines via injections into the skin. You know, under the skin. So there it is right there. Now, the autism rates in America. In 1985, there was a huge dip in terms of the number of individuals diagnosed with autism per the sample in the population. So in 1985, it was 1 in 2,500. That's when Neptune first entered Capricorn. By 1995, it went to 1 in 500. So 1 in 500 individuals were diagnosed with autism by 1995. Also, there's more stats. Like, if you want to, like, really look at it, just Google the rise in vaccines or increase in vaccines correlated with the rise in autism. It will really shock you. Also, during this Neptune Uranus conjunction in Capricorn period, you saw a rise in incarceration rates. So what's interesting is you really started to see the incarceration rate in America rise right at 1984. It was a steep incline from 1984. And like I said, Neptune entered Capricorn in 1984. Neptune deals with imprisonment, incarceration. Capricorn can deal with government systems, government policies. So think about the term, the prison industrial complex. So during this time period that I speak of, that's when the prison industrial complex emerged on the scene, where prison became corporatized, where corporations started to derive profits off of the rate of incarceration. So it was to corporation and the government's benefit, because government taxes corporations. It was to their benefit for the incarceration to increase. So if incarceration needs to increase, if the rate of incarceration needs to increase, what also needs to increase? Crime, right? Yes. So the internet emerged during this time period. Now, the internet began as a government research system. It began as ARPANET, which stands for Advanced Research Projects Agency Network. And that emerged on the scene in the 1960s. So the internet has been around a long, but it started off as a military tool. Now, they unleashed the internet to the public back in the 90s, and that's when the internet took off. So we entered the information age right at Uranus conjoined to Neptune and Capricorn, right in that time period. So those children that were born in that time period, they were brought up in that information age. They were brought up in the electronic age. And with that, with the Capricorn influence, you want to add into the whole internet porn industry and how internet porn is free-flowing and uninhibited on the internet, and how children have easy access to it through their cell phones, through their laptops, through their tablets. Capricorn, the Capricorn influence can deal with growing up too fast. So this generation, the generation that I speak of, has definitely grown up too fast to their own detriment. They haven't grown up too fast in terms of responsibility, but in terms of licentiousness and debauchery. Also, the gaming industry became mega popular during the time period that I speak of. So I just wanted to, before I close out hour one, I just wanted to get into some famous Nepturanians, just to give an example of how quirky and how odd some of these people can be. The first one is Miley Cyrus. She was born November 23rd, 1992. She has her sun making a semi-square to Uranus and Neptune in Capricorn. So she's one of the individuals afflicted. She has one of her personal planets afflicted by the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. And her Venus is right next to the conjunction. Now, Uranus conjoined to Venus can deal with you having alternative sexual appetites, or just alternative, you're attracted to, you have alternative or odd attractions. So she has mentioned that she's pansexual. So her Venus conjoined to Uranus and Neptune and Capricorn can deal with that all day. And what's interesting is Capricorn can deal with the god Pan, that goat-like figure that plays that flute. Yes. So Capricorn, pansexual, makes sense. Another Nepturanian is Azealia Banks. Anybody that knows about her, she's very cantankerous. She's very disruptive. She was recently in the news. Teamed up with RZA for this project with Russell Crowe, and her and Russell Crowe got into it, and she accused Russell Crowe of calling her a racial slur. She's always in the news about starting some shit with people. Her moon is right between Uranus and Neptune in Capricorn. So her moon was right between that Uranus and Neptune Capricorn conjunction. So she has it bad. That deals with her being naturally cantankerous, disruptive, uncompromising, just somebody that likes to create upset and dissension. And she's just naturally rebellious. She can't even help it if she try. And she's born on the 31st, which breaks down to 4, which is a very rebellious number because 4 vibrates to the planet Uranus. Another celebrity that's kind of odd is that Taylor Momsen. She's of the alternative rock or metal scene. She's born July 26, 1993. She's like, she has that whole satanic vibe going on. She started off being all kind of cutesy and like all, you know, kind of innocent or whatever. And then she transitioned into this like satanic, crazy looking chick. But anyway, her Mercury is opposing that Uranus Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. And she's born during the year where that conjunction was at its tightest, where it was at its closest, both at 19 degrees. Kendall Jenner. She's, Kim Kardashian's little sister, also Bruce Caitlyn Jenner's daughter, Kris Jenner's daughter. Her Mercury and North Node in Libra forms a square to that Uranus-Neptune conjunction. Now, North Node and Mercury in Libra, that deals with relationships. Libra deals with relationships. So we often get our first representation of relationships from who? Our parents. So with that challenging aspect between her North Node and Libra, and Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn can deal with her being in that dysfunctional family, her parents being dysfunctional, them being in a dysfunctional marriage, Bruce/Caitlyn Jenner and his transformation. So, yeah, she got caught up in the mess. Poor child. EJ Johnson is another one. That's Magic Johnson's son. He's very flamboyant. He's openly gay. He's gender fluid, as some would call it, and that's another manifestation of the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. A lot of people born during that time period are all into the gender fluid and the ambiguousness and the androgyny. And well, back in the day, we called it androgyny, but now they want to call it gender fluid. But it's nothing but androgyny, let's be real, and Uranus deals with androgyny. So he has his Gemini son. Gemini deals with androgyny. His Gemini sun and Mercury are forming a quincunx, which is a challenging aspect to the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. And then we have Mr. Tyler, the creator, the little dark-sided rapper who is the creator of the group Odd Future. When he first came on the scene, I was just like, oh, wow, rap has really taken a turn for the worse. Now, so, like a lot of people of that generation, though, they love this dude, and like they saw no problem with him espousing the tenets of Satanism and him putting the upside-down crosses and all that stuff. And when I saw it, I was, like, really taken aback because typically black people really don't get into a whole satanic thing, but he was, like, really championing it. I remember I saw this one video of him, and it really shook me to the core. It was really shocking and provocative. So that deals with that Uranus conjoint Neptune in Capricorn situation all day. Now, he was born on March 6, 1991. He's a Pisces, so he's already out there. His Venus is squaring the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. His Mars is forming a quincunx to the conjunction as well. Very weird kid. I mean, he, you know, you could call him creative in his own right, but yeah, that kid unsettled me. So he definitely is manifesting that Uranus-Neptune conjunction all day, so more power to him with that. Now, on the bright side, here are some of the things we can learn and gain from this unruly, peculiar conjunction of Uranus and Neptune in Capricorn. Some of the things we can embody is to question authority, to not be so quick to accept what the government is telling us or what the mass media is telling us. Also, to live life more on our own terms rather than being a slave to an oppressive system. Because these people that were born during this Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, they have no problem being rebellious and going up against authority and thumbing their nose at authority. Another thing we can learn is tolerance. And when I say tolerance, I don't mean just tolerating any old thing and, you know, leaning towards anarchy and chaos. What I mean by tolerance is understanding that we all have differences and respecting differences and not being so wrapped up in this whole political correctness scheme where, you know, you're afraid to speak your mind and where freedom of speech is being eroded. You know, that, like, in a, you know, it's really being ramped up where we really don't have much freedom of speech anymore. So people are all in their feelings nowadays and people get offended over the littlest thing. So Uranus in particular is about tolerance. So we can learn from Uranus and Capricorn where we could be more tolerant of differences and not get our panties in a bunch when somebody, you know, is saying something that goes against what we believe. Another thing we can learn from this is to get away from the notion that the 40-hour plus work week should be the norm. As a Uranian myself, I got Uranus on my midheaven. I'm also a Neptunian. I got Sun conjunct Neptune. You can also call me a Plutonian. I got Pluto square my ascendant. So I'm naturally rebellious myself. I don't like the total line. So I've always had a problem with the 40-hour work week. And I'm like, and I know where it comes from. It comes from the Industrial Revolution. People used to have to work far more many hours. But just because they scaled it down to 40 hours doesn't make it right or doesn't make it better. So I always wonder why, you know, these companies always stick to this 40-hour plus work week. And some of them try to get away with, you know, putting 60 hours or more on somebody. But yeah, we need to work smarter rather than harder. So Uranus conjoined to Neptune and Capricorn can deal with that all day, like finding solutions that can allow us or enable us to work smarter rather than harder. And I'm wrapping this up because we're into hour two and I got to open up the phone lines. But two more things we can gain. Also, understanding that old age does not necessarily equate to wisdom. So again, learning from this generation that had the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, they lack respect for authority figures. And just because you're old and gray does not mean that they're going to listen to what you say or, you know, even respect what you say. And they're going to dissect what you say and they're going to, like, try to find the truth for themselves. So oftentimes we give a lot of old people the pass. Dick Gregory. More on that. I might have another episode about that. I like Dick Gregory, but as of late, and I digress a little bit, but he's a perfect example of this. As of late, Dick Gregory is being interviewed, he's very ornery, he's very disruptive, he's very cantankerous, he's very rude and disrespectful to the interviewer. Now, Dick Gregory has a lot of wisdom, and he has a lot of knowledge and insight, and he speaks a lot of truth. However, just because you're old does not give you a pass to be disrespectful and to come across as this, you know, know-it-all, elitist snob who basically denigrates or downplays anyone who is not as knowledgeable as he is. So I just wanted to throw that out there. So understanding that old age does not necessarily equate to wisdom. And lastly, another thing we can learn and gain is that we can affect major change via social media nowadays. Social media has become the political platform of the new age, of the age of Aquarius. So that's Uranus conjoined to Neptune in Capricorn all day, because we have the ability, you know, more than ever to affect political change via the internet, via social media. And it's happening, even though with this presidency, it seems like, you know, the president is not so much elected, but selected. We can still try to affect change via social media in terms of local government and local laws and policies. So that's just my take on the Nepturanian generation. I hope you found this insightful. I'm going to ask you, Siku, to open up the lines for this second hour. So if anybody wants to call in and contribute to the discussion, please feel free. Or if you would like a mini reading, I'm all ears for that. So, you, Siku?
Hello. Yeah, nobody's pressed one at the time. Family, press one okay. If you like a reading or if you want to discuss this, and I'll open them. Did you check your phone? Because I actually sent you the information if you want to look at the board yourself.
Yeah, I just been mouthing on. I've been running my mouth. I didn't even check the phone yet. Oh, I just got it. Let me see. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
No, it's cool. I'm your engineer, but just in case if you want to just take a peek.
So while we're waiting to see if anybody's going to call in, do you want to contribute to this discussion? Do you have any insight or opinions on what I was discussing?
No, mine is more to, I was hoping between you and Rod, y'all give me information in terms of predicting things. Like, you know, we're all, you know, we do things that we're always analyzing after the fact. You know, like
yes.
you were saying, certain things happen that it would be nice if we got information that, you know, so we could predict what was going on, so we could try to deal with a positive energy to change it from affecting our community, you know, like that. Opposed to, you know, we know that certain combinations of things like Saturn and Pluto and Capricorn open certain portals, so certain energy they can do against us, but what can we do to prevent it? Or what can we do with that same energy to manage? Or just even to counter it? You know what I mean? Like that. So that's what I want. You know.
Yeah, like when I wrapped up that segment, that's basically what I was getting into when I talked about some of the things that we can learn and gain from that conjunction and that time period in particular, as well as the individuals that were born during that time period. And I also mentioned that I believe that a lot of individuals born during that time period are given a special mission in life, and they've been brought here to break the mold, so to speak, especially in terms of how you approach things in terms of career aspirations, career path, because that's that Uranus and Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. Capricorn deals with career. So a lot of people born during that time period, they've created their own careers, and a lot of it has emerged via online, via social media, via apps. That generation I speak of is, you know, they're like the trailblazers when it comes to creating apps for phones and whatnot. So definitely, like I said, that generation is here to break the mold, also in terms of spirituality as well, because I mentioned that a lot of those young people that came, that were born during that time period, they are more open to other forms of spirituality than the traditional religion. So those are some of the, that's, you know, some of the ways where, you know, that conjunction can manifest and how we can use it to our advantage in this day and age.
Okay, I'm there. Because, you know, the one what made me think about when you mentioned that there was a certain astrological alignment that worked when they increased the prison systems, and you know what I mean? So, you know, I was sitting there thinking, like, what if these people knew that was coming, which they probably did, so they decided
right.
that was the time to start bringing in incarcerating brothers and sisters. You see what I mean? And so
yes.
at that same time, there has to be something out there that say, well, they can do this, but what can we do to flip it? You know what I mean?
Right.
Even this, and I understand what you're saying that, you know, because I'm a believer in what Tony Broder says about when Mother Earth says there's certain things that need to come to this planet, she started manifesting it through the black woman. So I'm a believer in that, what you're saying. You just termed those particular children. You know, some people call them the crystal children, the rainbow children, what have you. You've been way more specific about it, which I honor that. I'm just saying, even for us people that aren't in there, what could we do? Any, you know, like me, I don't understand the stars like y'all do, but what can I do because I do ritual. Could you call
mm-hmm.
and who seeks to put them out or blah, 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 let's do it at this time. Like we're planning on family, we're planning on having the Halloween show next week where we're going to talk
mm-hmm.
about honoring our ancestors with Sister Robina is hosting. But, you know, that's the thing I would love for us to have, to even have, even if we had like a 12-month projection so folks know on this day, this month, you see what I mean? We need to be looking
yeah.
at this sort of thing. And I've been confronted about getting a group together again to do that. But I think we, you know, I'm waiting for more specifics so that I can say, well, you know what, family, let's get together. We're going to do this ritual, blah, 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 because these planets are in alignment. You know what I mean? I met you through, you know, we were doing, looking at the police thing in July. So
yeah.
It's just something I need. You know, and it was like when you think about why would Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan have one of the top astrologers in America in their office?
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
So, yep. Exactly.
They
now,
was
I'm
doing
trying to find
on
the
square.
Yes. And that's the thing. A lot of people in positions of authority, the powers that be, they subscribe to astrology. They subscribe to, you know, metaphysical of arts and sciences. So they use that in order to gain that leverage, to gain that advantage over the population.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
just like you said, President Reagan, Nancy Reagan, they had their astrologer, and, you know, they didn't openly say that, but that can be a manifestation of Neptune and Capricorn as well. You know, the presidency and them using that Neptune influence, that spirituality, them using astrology to make or to help them in their decision making. But yes.
Yeah. And you know, we're talking about people that look 10 years out. You know, because it's
yes.
that same snowball of what they've done to us. And the police killing now is based on the star alignment that they projected 10 years ago. And what process
right.
did they have to mentally do to move the people? You see what I mean? And so it's kind of like, you know, we taught them the stars, supposedly, and then now they're using it against us to try to go against the stars to stay in power, which is very interesting. You know what I mean? To some way.
Yes.
You know, because
some
of them really – go ahead, please.
Now, I was going to, because you had mentioned that how can we use that energy that I spoke of to our advantage. So just to add to that, that segment of the population that was born between 1989 and 1996, I believe that they have been endowed with special powers, whether you want to call it magical powers, or they are in touch with their spirituality in a way where they can really apply it in a practical sense. So they can take spirituality and give it practical application. So we need that segment of the population when it comes to bringing spirituality down to a level where the masses can benefit, or, you know, us in general, you know, the oppressed can benefit when, you know, let's say, for instance, we'll see a planetary transit that's coming up, you know, or, you know, for instance, when Pluto ingresses into Aquarius. Well, then those people that were born during that time period, they can take up the reins in terms of being in contact with the ancestors, because Capricorn can deal with old people and history. So they can have a direct link with the ancestors, a lot of them, because that Uranus conjoined to Neptune, that configuration, that gives somebody a lot of spiritual power and a lot of occult power. So a lot of these people born during that time period, they may not even realize how powerful they are. Case in point, my oldest daughter, she was born in 1994, so she was born during this Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. And my daughter is extremely psychic, even though she tries to downplay her skills, and she really doesn't. I always tell her she needs to develop her skills. But when she was really little, I would say from the time that she was like between 2 and up, me and her, we could communicate telepathically. So if I wanted her to come near, I would just think about it, and she would say, "Huh, Mom, did you call me?" before I would even get it out of my mouth, like, you know, "Come here." So that's just one example, and that's on a very low level in terms of psychic ability and occult gifts, of how that generation has that direct linkage with spiritual world and these spiritual gifts and how they can apply it in a practical sense. And my daughter has used her psychic gifts to get her friends out of trouble or to, you know, prevent trouble and things like that when she's out with her friends and stuff. So, yes.
So that leads me to my next question. Realistically, what do you think the odds of us failing with this transition, or what do you think are the odds that the side that want to have global control of this planet will succeed?
When you say transition, are you talking about Pluto entering Aquarius?
No, I'm talking about. There's a side of the government that wants a one-world government on this planet.
Okay.
And they use astrology to their advantage. And even though Mother Earth is bringing in these children, teaching the children what's necessary to stop that one-world government. So I'm asking you, what do you think the odds that one side may win over the other? Because, see, I don't think it's an automatic just because the energy is there that we can just, oh, Lord, it's going to happen, and we've got to relax on it and let it happen. You know what I mean? I believe that if these people didn't believe that they could use that same energy to have a one-world government, they wouldn't be trying. You know what I mean? So
right.
Do you think – what do you, when you look at your charts, what do you say realistically and logically? What do you say?
Well, I hate to say it, but I feel like the powers that be, they're winning. And they're winning because a lot of people are complacent and they've just either given up caring, or, you know, they just feel like this thing is too big, or is too big for them to even care about. When I spoke about that time period with the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, I believe that that was the paradigm shift for this one-world government. And if you notice, in the late 80s, George Bush Sr., he was the first president to talk about a new world order. So that right there deals with the Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn that started taking place chiefly in 1989, 1990. So I believe that that Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, while it bolstered the powers that be up and it gave them a big leap forward, I believe that it really resulted in our downfall as a people because we were caught off guard. So that's the whole lesson to be learned in knowing astrology and, you know, giving high esteem to what astrologers do, because if more people were up on astrology, we would have saw this trend coming, and maybe we would have been better prepared for it. But we were totally caught off guard by that Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, but that is the essence of those two planets coming together, because Uranus deals with things that are unexpected, and Neptune deals with deception and secrecy or illusion. So late 80s, early 90s, a lot of people were under the illusion that things were getting better, especially, you know, in terms of race relations, in terms of, you know, because especially, like, think about hip-hop. We went through that period where, you know, it was that Afrocentric movement, and it was De La Soul and Tribe Called Quest and Jungle Brothers and, you know, you wore the African medallions and all that. So we had all of this black pride, but then it quickly shifted over into gangster rap. So all of that took place during that time period that I speak of. And what's interesting is Neptune does deal with music. So the whole music industry is wrapped up into that nefarious conjunction as well. But like I said, I feel like we were adversely impacted because we were caught off guard. We didn't realize how sophisticated the government was.
What alignment is the portal for us to bring energy through to counter their thing?
I wouldn't say it's a particular. I wouldn't say it's a particular alignment. But I would say we are at a really optimal time with Uranus being in Aries, because Uranus deals with revolution, deals with overturning oppressive systems. And in Aries, it gives you that fight. It gives you that vigor. It gives you that pioneering spirit. It can bring forth a new day as a result of revolution and rebellion. So we are at an optimal time right now, and I believe it does seem like a lot of people are becoming more enlightened slowly but surely. So I do feel like we are at the perfect time to really start creating this shift, but it's going to take many more people to make this happen. And unfortunately, right now, there's not enough of us who are conscious to be able to affect positive change.
Do you see yourself in the position to teach them I mean, for instance, you know, I've had some students, you know, and then, like, it's the same. Like, I mean, I don't have the capability, but my daughter is telepathic, too.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And she can go in a room and tell who is, even if they don't know they are. And she can broadcast into them. You know, so they've given us the weapon. They're kind of giving us the weapon, but it's how do we teach them or direct them? So what about Mars, though? What is my planet? Where do it have to be to bring cell mech into this whole thing?
Now, Mars moves very fast when compared to the outer planets like Uranus, Neptune, even Saturn. So with Mars, you're going to go through certain trends, but these trends are going to be very short in duration. So we came out of Mars and Sagittarius, and with Mars and Sagittarius, you saw a stronger push for freedom and justice. And then now we're in Mars is in Capricorn, which can deal with, you know, things being more ramped up in terms of government affairs, so the election and all of that stuff, and things getting fired up on the political end. You in particular, I would have to look at your chart to see how Mars could activate. But you in particular, I believe, yeah, your Mars is in Capricorn, so you're coming upon your Mars return. So you're at an optimal period right now, because Mars return can bring forth renewal of your drive, of your motivation. It can bring new motivation. It can take you in new directions and give you increased passion regarding what you already have put in place. So you're actually at a really good time. So use this time, this Mars return that you're about to enter, to your advantage and start something. Like, this would be a perfect time for you to start a new project.
Okay, I got you. Which I'm in, but, you know, I just want to know because we gotta be able to do it a couple times and prove to the young folks that it does work, so they have a viable option. Because I don't think we really have to always give them money to prove.
Right.
But, I've been around some of them young boys. I think we just have to be able to prove to them that if they align themselves, you know, this planetary battle, we can win. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like that. Because I'm not,
yeah.
You know, I have some friends that believe that since we're going in the golden age, it's going to automatically happen. And I'm like, I don't think it's like that. You know, I don't think they understand that there's a lot of species from all over the universe, and it's like this is the line in the sand, and it can go either way with Mother Earth. You know what I mean? Because, you know, I have friends that's into the sun cycle, so they think just because the planet is going to raise to the fifth dimension, it's going to be okay. But hell, it's fifth dimension reptilian. You see what I mean? So, you know. But anyway, I'm taking you off base, but I just, you know, I wanted to see, and I appreciate you for being who you are, for being practical, because I think for us to be practical means that we will be guiding the children instead of giving them the Jesus theory. You know, just wait, child. Jesus going to take care of it. No, because they're coming warriors. You know what I mean?
Yes. And a lot of that younger generation, they're not really having that anyway. Like, they're not buying it, the whole, you know, Christian or Judaism doctrine or even Islam doctrine to a certain extent. And namely, it's because the people that talk the talk don't walk the walk a lot of times, the people in those religious hierarchy positions. So they have become jaded and disillusioned with traditional religious systems. So it's actually good that they're more open-minded, and they, you know, because every generation has a spiritual center or spiritual base, or otherwise we're going to just enter into extreme chaos and anarchy. So the younger generation, they're starving for that spiritual center. And the good thing is, like I said, they're largely responsible for the emergence or reemergence of the occult, metaphysics, and sciences, arts and sciences such as astrology, numerology, and whatnot. I have a lot of followers who are of that time period that I speak of, who are in their early 20s, and they are very impressionable, but they're also very discriminating at the same time. They don't just take things at face value. So that's the manifestation of that Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. And while it's important to be able to predict events that are going to come to pass and see how we can avert impending doom or danger, I think it's also important to understand the past, even from an astrological perspective, so that it can give us a frame of reference in terms of our modern day and times. Because what happens in terms of astrology, like I said, astrology is life. So with that Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn, even though that happened in the time period I spoke of in the late 80s, early 90s, it still had that effect, still carries on. Same as the effects of slavery, even though it's been hundreds of years in the past, the deleterious effects of slavery still carry on into this current existence in these modern times. So the same thing with these aspects. That conjunction is still manifesting that energy because it manifests through the people that were born during that time period, but it also manifests per the events that went down and the laws that were changed and all of that. So it's like a domino effect, how certain major transits and major aspects and planetary configurations have upon not just the individual, but the world as a whole. So I do think it's very important to have some discussion every now and then about past trends from an astrological perspective. And it helps people to learn.
The other part of your show was, you know, it was very serious when you went into that. No, because a lot of people don't understand. I've learned since I've been listening to Rod Cook, at some point y'all could teach a history class. Because it seems like the better he get at his profession, the more he links in and connects. And the more you link and connect history and what the stars was doing back in that time, so people start seeing the pattern. So it gets very deep than just opening a newspaper and reading what it is. It's very serious what y'all do. So I watched you on the first part of your show when you did the history thing. You know what I mean? I think sometimes people underestimate it, so they don't understand. Some of my audience sometimes think it's boring, but they don't listen long enough to understand that to get to what the answers you want, it ain't always entertainment. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like that. And so to understand that, I've seen Ra even augment when they said stuff was happening in history because it didn't fit upstairs. You know, and I'm sure you do the same sometimes. You see some history. It's like, they said that. No, I couldn't because it didn't fit upstairs because those stars aligned up there was not bringing that energy in like they said it was. You know, like Civil War didn't happen like they said. You see what I mean? And folks don't understand, and they need to understand it because the powers that be, when they brought that white lady, Reagan brought that white lady in to start doing this stuff. And it was serious because Reagan, at some point, they had, when Reagan got shot, that was to rein him in. You know, you see what I mean? Because he, you know, they love him after, but after, that was after he pledged into that, but prior to him getting shot. You know, then after that, he got reined in. Then they brought their astrologer in. You see what I mean? Like that. Nancy was like, yo, hey. You see what I mean? But when you read certain things or, you know, listen to certain other things, Reagan wasn't always beloved. But one of the points is, what about the energy of California and the impact of those shots? You know, and as California goes, you know, sometimes the country goes. So it's very interesting. Mm-hmm. Can we look at what's the most probable time that they'll start doing shots for the entire United States? Is that possible to look at, like, under the stars again?
Oh, yeah. I would just need, you know, I would need to take some time, get my astrological microscope out and, like, really look at the different transits that are coming down the pike. But, yeah, that definitely can be determined or delineated. And I'd say we could probably get it down to within the month that they actually institute that law. So you're talking about vaccinations, right, where they have Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, because I think California now has a zero opt-out policy. You know, like if your kids is there, you know, then
right,
they have to take the shots. You can't even – I think they got rid – California got rid of the religious exemption.
Yes, like yes, I heard about that too. So, yeah, now that right there is a perfect manifestation of Pluto in Capricorn because Pluto is transiting Capricorn right now. So Pluto in Capricorn can deal with a government that is exercising draconian measures. So that would definitely be draconian, where you're forcing people to get vaccinations, even though it goes against their religion, even though it goes against their spirituality. That's actually criminal, if you ask me, and Pluto deals with criminal activity. And it's intrusive, and it's overstepping the boundaries, and that's Pluto all day as well, where, you know, somebody wants total control over your personal life. And I believe that our body should be our own, you know, our body is our body, and the government should not be involved in what goes in and out of our body. So that whole vaccination requirement, where it's a requirement, I believe that's a slippery slope, and I hope that the rest of the states don't follow through with that. But the way this country is headed, I wouldn't be really surprised. And we still have a long way to go with Pluto and Capricorn, because Pluto is still fairly in the fairly early degrees. It's only at 15 degrees of Capricorn right now, so we have another 15 degrees to go, and Pluto moves very, very slowly. So we have to really buckle up and just get ready for what's coming.
Very serious. So what about right now Mars and Venus? Aren't they like 15 degrees apart or something like that?
Okay.
Yeah, Mars and Venus. Because you have Mars, you have Venus like in the west, and then Mars is in the southwest. And then you have Saturn in between them. Well, Mars and Pluto
now,
are together almost within 5 degrees,
yeah,
right?
They're very close together.
Okay.
They're both at 15 degrees right now in Capricorn.
Okay.
And then Venus right now is at 2 degrees of Sagittarius. So, yes,
okay,
you're right about Saturn being between the two.
Yeah, see, I don't
but
read
yeah.
it. I just go out and look. I'm starting to get ready to look. You
but
know,
that
is
Mars...
Is Saturn affecting more Venus right now? Or family, like, it's like if you go out, like, right before it get dark, you're going to see Venus. And then as it
mm-hmm.
gets dark, you just look up, you know... Look up and left, and you'll see Mars like that. They're,
mm-hmm.
they're really easy to see right now. But
okay.
Saturn is in between. So which one does Saturn affect actually now? Does it affect more Venus, which Saturn is like restriction on love right now?
Uh-huh.
Or?
Well, Saturn would be, like you're right, it would be affecting Venus more so. They're both in Sagittarius, and they're 11 degrees apart. And Venus is approaching a conjunction to Saturn. Now, in terms of how it's going to affect the individual, it may not affect a person at all if it's not hitting up certain key points in their chart. So,
okay.
for instance, let's say when Venus lands on Saturn, let's say that that conjunction ends up in a person's seventh house. Well, they might be going through a separation in their relationship, but it might most likely it will be a brief separation because that transit is very short in duration. Or it could just be that, you know, they have a reality check in their relationship where they need to air out their grievances because that energy is that Sagittarius energy. So the truth may come out regarding somebody's extracurricular activities within a relationship. So that's, you know, some ways that it can manifest. But like I said, I can't stress it enough. If it's not affecting you personally, like your natal chart personally, just because Venus, transiting Venus is landing on transiting Saturn does not mean that you're going to be personally affected. But you will be more so affected
okay.
if that conjunction is on your ascendant, which contains your rising sign, or if it's on your fourth house cusp or your seventh house cusp or your mid heaven. Those are the angles. And then also, if that conjunction takes place in the eighth house, as well.
One day we're going to have to put those charts up and let them roll. You know what I mean? Like one day we're going to have to put the charts where we can do like the slides so people can go refer to them as they look online or, you know, like that. And I have had the capability of doing where a person was talking and people could look at their computer to, so they could see exactly what was going on. But it would be nice, you know. Because, I mean, you and Ra always, every time I think I got it, y'all throw in another little curveball, you know. It's like, dang, I got to learn that. Now I got to learn where it's at in my seventh house, for real? You know what I'm saying?
But that's part of the reason why I call myself the realist astrologer, because I deal with real world astrology. So I really don't get into generalized horoscopes. I don't write them. I don't offer them. I don't really get into general transits. So like I said, even though Venus is going to be conjoined to Saturn in a few days, I'm not the type that would go on my Facebook page and discuss it, because, like I said, for a lot of people, it may not even apply because it's not hitting a sensitive part in their chart. You see what I'm saying? So I like to deal with the person at hand when I'm discussing transits, but those transits are good when you're dealing with mundane astrology, and mundane astrology just basically deals with astrology in terms of the world at large or nations and whatnot.
Okay. I feel you. That'll take a little learning, but, you know, I can relax. I have time for that. But my goal is, you know, I'm doing some of my projects now is trying to educate people on looking at martial law. You know, it's like me and Committee, you're going to do another show, so we want to look at, can you and Rod tell me when it starts that they may implement another practice, or when's the best, you know, when you look at the things they've done with Hurricane Matthew, were there some indications of that in the stars that's why they chose that weekend? You see what I mean? Like that.
Right. And then, I could, we could definitely get into that with the next episode. And what's going down right now with Mars in conjunction to Pluto in Capricorn? That right there, like, would be a perfect recipe for them to pull another false flag, or for them to experiment with a form of martial law, because that Mars conjunct Pluto can deal with, you know, extreme force, excessive force, or where the government's really clamping down on people or restricting or where they're, like, exercising controls. So, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if something's not going down right now in the world that we'll find out about tomorrow.
Well, it was a brother that came on Beverly D's show from Savannah. He was saying, if, you know, and he didn't sound like he was lying, but he basically said in Savannah, they just took the black neighborhood and, like, y'all got to get on the bus and y'all got to go. And then they put a curfew. And if you was out after that curfew, bam, you was gone. And I know in South Carolina, one of my coworkers said his friends that came up, he called them refugees. You see what I mean? And so when we looked up what the word refugee means, it means a people without a country. So and when the guy got back, they looked at his license and told him what shelter to go to. You see what I mean? So it looks like you're seeing it in the stars, and it's like, I want to know that again in the stars, because what they did in Savannah and what they did in South Carolina, and then, you know, it was one mayor that basically said, we don't know what happened, you know, is it dam ruptured or not, which kind of like he implied that all that flooding was because they blew some dams. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But all of it, and then that same last weekend, then they came out with the executive order for space weather, you know. So
now,
you know, if they're doing it,
okay.
Go ahead.
But I was just going to speak about a manifestation. I just saw this right now on my Facebook. Manifestation of Mars conjunct Pluto in Capricorn going down right now is the presidential debate, which could probably explain why we don't have any callers. because everybody might be tuned into the
debate. Yeah, you know they are. Without a doubt, they are. Yeah, I forgot all about it.
So that's Mars conjunct Pluto in Capricorn all day because it's intense at this point, and it's heated. I haven't been watching it, but I'm going to check out some of it. But, yeah, that's the manifestation of Mars conjunct Pluto in Capricorn because Capricorn is government, politics, presidency.
Yeah, you're right. He probably – it's funny because, you know, but I won't go there. But the radius is high, so I'm sure they are. You know, this is the last one, and they're one apiece. And, you know, they're pulling some high ratings, you know, so, yeah. You know, because they kind of it's been – I've been listening to some stuff, and they got – you know, I've even listened to some white people that was honest enough to kind of – some white people, you know, not good or bad white people, but I was just talking to some that – some of them really just don't know who to vote for. You know what I mean? Like that.
Yeah.
Because they like Trump, but then they seeing, you know, like, yo, man, this dude crazy, you know. And, you know, I'm not a part of the I'm not a citizen, so I can't vote. My trust can vote, but I can't, you know.
Okay.
But, my whole point is that if I could go in with a contract with Trump, I'd rather sit down with Trump than Hillary and Bill, really. You know, it's like, I hate to say
it. Oh, wow. Now, you know, a lot of people would look at you like, why are you supporting Trump? Are you crazy? But, yeah, I try not to even get involved. But that's interesting you say that. So tell me why you would rather sit down with Trump than Hillary.
Because I think that if he was just doing a legitimate businessman, I think that, you know, he did say some things that are very true that ain't no politician said. When he said that black folks are in bad shape and it's getting worse, you know, and the NAACP jumped up and your president. But it was the truth. It was the truth. Our communities are getting worse up under Democrats. It's the truth. That man did not lie. Now, it's just unfortunate, you know, that you know, he sleeps in the back room with David Duke. That's why I would say a contract. Let me, you know, let's put together a contract, and then this is some of the things that if we deliver these votes, these are some of the things we want. You see what I mean?
Right.
Like that. And if not, give me some of your hair. Because if I get your hair and you don't do right, I'm going to give it to all my magician friends. You see what I mean? Something like that. I'm very serious about it. But the whole point is he didn't lie. When he went to Detroit, he tried to tell black people something that is very, very true. They've been dealing with a race of people. First of all, black folks don't know how important their vote is. Like Bill Clinton, I seen him sit down one day, and he, you know, they talked about why he concentrated on certain things, and he basically said white America was split 48-48. You see what I mean? Democrats, Republicans, they're almost even in the white community at that time. So, you know, you had to work on the swing, and the swing was the black people. And it's about that same thing again. You see what I mean? And so, but black people don't look at it in terms of collectively saying, hey, you know what? Trump was right. You know, we might as well try something different, maybe, you know, because it's going to be worse. I mean, like they say, Hillary and Bill locked up more black people than any other president, you know, and we just run to him like he, you know, like that. She ain't right. Plus, not she.
And that's,
we won't get off. Go ahead.
But but that's exactly what I was saying about that time period that I spoke of and that conjunction and the rise in incarceration that happened under Clinton's presidency. But it's funny that they coined President Clinton as like the first black president, where, you know, he was supposed to be this cool dude, played the saxophone and everything. Meanwhile, he's increasing the incarceration rate of the very people that society claims that he, you know, is all in touch with. So, yeah, that's
right.
The irony of it all. But, yeah, that's why I made it a point to speak about the presidencies during that time period, because Clinton was largely instrumental for the rise in incarceration rates, the tremendous rise. And the rise, and you can't explain that rise simply by, oh, there was an increase in births or there was more people in the country, because the increase is just exponential almost in terms of the amount of people that have been locked up ever since 1984. And when you consider the fact that crime is still rampant, I mean, sometimes some years it's on a decline, other years it's on the incline, but for the most part, society, especially inner city neighborhoods, has not improved. And opportunities have not improved.
Period. It's been 1% back since slavery, and that's what black people don't see. They need to go, you know, read I forget the author's name, but yeah, Claude Anderson's book. A couple of Claude Anderson's books. He put it out there, the numbers, and it hasn't changed. You know, but
oh yeah, I like Claude Anderson.
I'm not a pessimist. It's just we got to look at the energy of it. You know, those people.
Yes.
Even Obama is about rolling to a one world government. You know, and the only two people that really aren't close to that one world government is Trump and Putin. You see what I mean? And it's like, you know, when you, you know, I listen to a lot of world news, you know, like I do news, but I don't do local. I have a lot of world news. I find news stations. And, you know, when you look at certain parts of it, like now there's some predictions, even Robert X said, it's like they may go after Putin to bring him in. You see what I mean? And they got and Trump is not, you know what I mean? He's not a part of it, but he's a right. You know, he's a white supremacist. You see what I mean? Or and if he's not, he's came off as a white supremacist. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and they could be portraying him, and I believe it because they portrayed him. But I believe, you know, my personal opinion is, you know, for some reason he's made a mockery out of the two parties. You know that stuff he said about check Hillary's drug test. That's you know, there's people that really believe she a clone. You know what I'm saying? So that's deep what he said. They're making him look stupid, but that's deep because if you get her blood test and see what she on. One day she up, one day she down, then she disappears and bombing his wife campaigning. How sick is that lady? You see what I mean? It's just how he say it. You know what I mean? But if you listen to what he's saying, it's like, wait a minute, maybe he's telling us. You know what I mean? Like that time he did that thing and put that star on her, right? And they was like, oh, that's anti-Semitic, blah, blah, blah. But when you look at it from a different point, was he trying to say she really that? You see what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Like little things he be saying about her, you know, when he said that he'll lock her ass up for them emails, it's true. She should be. You see what I mean? Like that. It's
right.
True. And they, how many white boys you ever known in the election that ever would do that? Ever? Never, it ain't never happened. But I mean, even as dingy as Baby Bush was, he's never been that, you know, the bold to tell white folks how sneaky and nasty they are to their face, and he one of them. It ain't happened,
right?
But he told, you know, when he brought Clinton, all Clinton's hoes, here all his hoes, I brought them up front for you. You know what I'm saying? Like, what? You know, they don't do that. You see what I mean? But how he's been portrayed to minorities and women, you know, and how he's made everybody that bowed down, you know, or the media has painted him as, you know, that, because it could be painting him as that because it makes you as a minority afraid of him, you know. But when you look at some of the things he said about, and he's one of them, you'd be like, no wonder, you know what I mean? And he's just rich, because if he wasn't, he'd long been dead. You know, they'd have buried him next to Abraham Lincoln. You know what I mean? Big time.
Uh-huh.
You know? The Clinton? Oh, yeah, they'd long killed that boy. Yeah, you know. But he's so rich, and he got his number two man is great with intel. You see what I mean? So he know when they're trying to kill him, you know.
Yeah.
His number two man is great with intel. He ain't no fool. But the point is that, you know, and then there's people that like him in the government that leak stuff to him just like they leak it to Dick Gregory. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like that. But I don't know. That's it, thing.
Oh.
We're going to raise our children, and we're going to take this planet and make it, you know, bring it back in line with some of the other planets that, you know, had to fight to get rid of that alien energy.
I'm glad you mentioned Dick Gregory. I'm glad you mentioned Dick Gregory because I brought him up briefly when I was discussing how we could learn from that Uranus conjunction, Uranus-Neptune conjunction in Capricorn. So some people might, you know, take offense to what I said about him, but I meant what I said. Like, I feel like he's very wise. He's very, you know, knowledgeable, and he speaks a lot of truth, but his delivery
cut you off for about 10 seconds. Repeat that whole sentence. You, like, went out.
I'm sorry. But what I was saying is Dick Gregory, he's very knowledgeable, and he has a lot of wisdom, and he speaks a lot of truth, but it's his delivery of the message that needs to improve. And I think that he's of the notion that just because he's old in age that he can be disrespectful and rude. But we need people like him to reach out to the young generations and, you know, help educate them on how this system really works. And I feel like he could be a great source of knowledge, but a lot of times what he says is lost on his demeanor and his attitude. And so I just wanted to just talk about just that, just because someone's older doesn't mean that they automatically should be given respect, and that you should allow yourself to be disrespected just because this person has 50 years on you. Because I noticed that there's this one interviewer in particular that Dick Gregory is always letting him have it. And it depends on the question that he asks him, but he's always yelling at him and stuff. And I'm just like, wow. And then I'll read the comments on YouTube, and a lot of people are picking up on that too. And some people think it's funny. Some people love it, but other people are starting to really like just pull back from him a little bit, because they're seeing that, you know, he's not too cordial. He's not too agreeable. But and I think a lot of his message gets lost on his cantankerousness. But I just wanted to talk about that.
You know what, though?
Like,
that's a good point. It's a good point, because there's some things that he says that I totally don't agree with. You know what I mean?
Me
like
too.
The whole black church and the black woman thing. No, that ain't happening. Now, they have the potential, but they are not working in our favor either. You know what I mean? Like, he'll say, it's a black woman in a black church. I'm like, blah, blah, blah. But I do, you know, it's amazing. He's one of the few civil rights people that have made the transition to the conscious community, because the conscious community are really kind of on him a lot. But my personal opinion is, I appreciate the piece he gave about he went to a metaphysical practitioner, and that's the only reason why he's alive. And I play that a lot, you know, on this network, to let certain folks know, when you're out there running your mouth, you need to go get the metaphysical. You need to see Rabina family so she can protect you. You see what I mean? Like that. I'm serious.
Yeah.
I believe that with all my heart. It happened to me. The universe gave me that type of protection. So, yeah, I agree with him with that. But I think sometimes his message ain't even new enough to stay with where he at. You know what I mean?
I agree.
It becomes, after you listen to him enough, it gets repetitive. And
yes,
so,
he goes in circles.
You know, but,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But that's his thing, because he hasn't really truly released to the metaphysical world. He's still very civil rightish.
Yes.
You know, like that. And so he hasn't, so for him to transition, some of them things he says about his grandkids and the crystal kids, he said one thing, and if you listen long enough, then he's saying no. It's almost like the Bible, you know, or is metaphysics good or bad? You know what I mean? But, you know, it's Dick. He made the transition. I think that it's hard to define it. Like, I'm an older guy. I worked around a lot of prisoners in my last job. They would call me sir. And there was a level of respect, even though some of them have been in prison since they was, you know what I mean? But it's hard to, there is a etiquette that I would prefer we stay. And I think we should have that etiquette with our people or with our community, period. And we don't have to give that etiquette based on respect, but just an etiquette. You know what I mean? Because at first they was called, some of them called me old school. And I'm like, look, I really don't like that. Call me Baba. You know what I mean? If you can't pronounce Husiku, call me Brother You, but just don't assume that It's old school. You see what I mean?
Right.
And some of them, they were cool about it. So I think that our etiquette that goes back to, you know, to wherever you think you come from, it's still there. It's still inbred in our community. Because, I mean, that job I was on, damn near every black, I was the only black man there that, no, it was about three of us that didn't have a record, wasn't coming out of prison. You see what I mean?
Okay.
But you can still see that we have a communal etiquette that go back to our grandparents. It's just not being used as much, you know, unless they look at, you know, once they realize I was always trying to give them some knowledge and blah, 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 then, you know, you have to earn it with the young kids. But it should be that etiquette should be there. Then respect let somebody gain. You know what I mean? Like
right.
that. Because it'll be good for our community. And Dick, can you know, you can get that. You march with the old heads, blah, blah, blah. You can get the etiquette. I can give him respect. I want to challenge some of the things he got to say. You know what I mean? Because I don't particularly. We're not in a better place from the civil rights movement, and the black church ain't changing nothing in our community. You know, so why is the black church, you know, or the black woman? Now, could the black woman change something in our community? Yeah. You know what I mean? Do I expect it to? Hell no. Because I don't want to get off into that game if you did or didn't. I'm just saying, it's a difference between potential energy and kinetic energy. That's all I'm saying.
Right.
You know, yeah, the black man and the black family, all got the ability to change this motherfucker, never use the house, because we all could be metaphysical. But is it the greatest thing that ever happened? No, because it ain't moving shit. No, really, it's not. You see what I mean? So
yeah.
It's like people say, black people are naturally spiritual. No, you're spiritual when you're spiritual. Now, do we have the potential to be able? Yes, we do, because we're melanated. But
right.
The more that I've had to open up, there's a lot of white people that's melanated. You know, there's a lot of powerful white people. So you can't even say that certain spirituality is, you can always look at every black person and say, you're going to be spiritual. That ain't true, because there's some dead black people, you know what I mean? Just like there's some dead white people. And you know what I mean? And then I can go around some white people and they can read, and go around some black people and read. You know, there's some metaphysical white people who are just as scared of us as Trump, or scared that we're going to, you know what I mean? Like sometimes if you go visit some metaphysical shops with some white people, because one thing about us metaphysical black people, we can always see the silver lining, but there's the metaphysical white people in Asheville, they don't see a silver lining because they see this great white machine that's going to destroy everything. You see what I mean? So a lot of them don't see beyond, you know what I mean? Like that. It's very deep. Because I can go up and talk to them because, you know, I go up there because I sell Oregon to most of those metaphysical stores in Asheville. And, you know, just to say, you know what, man, they're going to send the spirit down here and the death angel going to walk this country. That white people don't believe that, and they be metaphysical. You know, it stops at a point when they look at the atom bomb. You know what I mean? A lot of them, and I'm sure there's some white people that be like, I already met that spirit. You know, because what I'm learning is you can't just generalize no more. You can't just say white folks don't have soul. Bull crap. You see what I mean? Or you can't say that black people are spiritual. No, they ain't. Because the ones that follow Jesus, they ain't, you know what I mean? They ain't busting the bubble, you know. But there are some spiritual people that do deal with the Jesus thing or the Bible, you know. I think we can win, but we're going to have to unite. And not only unite.
Definitely.
If we unite, we're going to have to unite with people from other worlds. And we're going to have to learn how to communicate with the people from the inner world to win. I believe it's going to take all of that. Because Hillary's a clown. No.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't take over your show. I'm sorry, God. You know. I'm sorry.
That's okay. But we've come to the end of the show, it looks like. But I enjoyed myself for episode 4. I hope we had some listeners. I know we had that presidential debate going on, so I understand if a lot of people didn't tune in, but hopefully people will be able to listen to the podcast at a later date. But peace and blessings, everyone.
Have a good night, Usiku, and I'll be in touch.
Thank you. All right. And,
all right,
and
good night.
Even if you're tonight or you listen to the podcast, tomorrow we have Ryle Cool. Friday we have Brother Eddie doing numerology. And then next Wednesday, Sister Robina sits down with Jerry, and we're going to look at the spirituality and Jerry Miller and the spirituality in Halloween. And with that, peace and blessings.
Yes, I'm looking forward to it. Peace and blessings.
When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to Geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your moves.
When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to Geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your move.